Questions? What?
So thank you, Leo. Amazing richness and interesting phenomena and beautiful talk. So I'm wondering, if you compare this critical phases to cosmic talus physics, where you have nonlinear transport, do you find similar effects?
Well, so the column, this may be a little bit, we'll lose some members of the audience, but yeah, so this is a great question. So in Costello's, this logarithmic fluctuations in three dimensions for these critical phases happens in two dimensions for an XY model, two-dimensional superfluid film, or two-dimensional ferromagnet. There, you're described by a fixed line, so there's no universality. You give me a modulus, superfluid density, and I'll tell you with some finite amount of flow, I'll tell you what the stiffness is, and different system will be characterized by different systems. So the exponents are non-universal, as you know, they go as T over K. Here, there's a fixed point that's attractive, and you really are flowing to that universal fixed point. So here, this is the physics, as opposed to fixed line. So that's one. So there's an overlap in the sense of if I really sit just in three dimensions, it turns out, I didn't say this, a little kind of a white lie, this fixed point is 3 minus d away from this fixed point. So in three dimensions, this fixed point is actually a Gaussian fixed point. So it's like being in four dimensions of 5-4 theory at the critical point. So it's 3 is the upper critical dimension, so you have to be below 3 to actually have it be at a finite value here. But still, let's just talk about two dimensions. For example, then it sits here, it's non-perturbative, and it predicts universal exponents. But if you sit in three dimensions, it's very similar to Costello-Staus in the sense of they both have logarithmic fluctuations, but here logarithmic fluctuations are in three dimensions rather than two dimensions. And that has to do with the softness in this perpendicular direction and underlying rotational invariance of these layers. But yeah, but the connection is is a good point to Costello-Staus.
If you can speak loud.
Thank you very much for very interesting talk. A couple of naive questions, or maybe like from quantum questions. So you mentioned this in TBN, you mentioned that the angle is coupled to the displacement. It's a kind of a law.
Oh, good.
It reminds the momentum to spin law in the topological norms. Is it somehow related?
Not quite. Okay, so there, the locking is not spontaneous. While here, the locking is spontaneous when you go into this helical state. So inside the phase, yes, the locking is quite similar. And you can just understand it very simply from this picture. Well, okay, from the gauge theory point of view, something that I skipped, that I didn't want to burden you with, what happens is, so what happens is, you see it here, if you have some more field theory background, so what ends up happening is you say, I'm going to allow the system to be twisting, here's a twisting, okay, but I'm going to allow E1 and E2 to be arbitrary, spatially dependent, and the phase is arbitrary. Okay, so that's a most general description of this twisted phase and its distortions. But now what happens is, after some long song and dance or some massaging, that grad phi couples to the E3 of the orthonormal triad. So then what happens at low energies, these two things want to be zero. And that's like the Higgs mechanism, where they lock together. And so now, and it's pretty clear from this layered structure, if I have a layered structure, I have a normal immediately to it. It's kind of integrability of these layers. If it's a single valued set of layers, I have a height function. If I have a height function, then I can define the normal is actually a gradient to the surface. And if I have a gradient, in other words, having these single valued functions means I have a normal. And what are these functions? These are equal orientational surfaces. And that's why this normal E3 of this orthonormal triad locks to the layers. And so all I need to know is where I am and what layer I'm in, and I know immediately what E3 is. So this guy exactly locks 2e3. So there's definitely some similarity, except here it kind of happens dynamically. You know, you just need to enter that phase.
But it reminds me of fractoning dynamics, right? Fractals.
There's a little bit of that, yes. It's because what really should remind you of fractonic is the fact that the second derivative. So like there's a dipole conservation that's hidden there. That's true. That's true. There's some similarity.
More questions? Fawad?
So in the case where some of the gold stones are Higgs, what is the physical description of the local symmetry?
Well, that's kind of captured by this slide. The local symmetry is really, you know, locally, at any one point, you have this orthonormal triad. So if you, you know, try to excite the system at short scales, shorter than this pitch, then you would really see three sets of fluctuations, three Euler angles fluctuating. But when you go to longer and longer scales, corresponding to inverse of this k, the bigger the k, the smaller the length scale you need to go to for it to lock, then eventually this locking will set in, or this locking will set in, and then, and you know, physically or geometrically what it is, it's this establishment of these layers. So the locking occurs from the orthonormal triad to a single goldstone mode on a scale beyond the period or pitch of this helical structure. And then, sort of, on scales longer than that, you basically say, this looks like a constraint. It wants to be zero. And that's exactly what happens sort of mathematically, not physically, what happens in the Higgs mechanism, where this would be like some matter, a phase of some bosonic matter, maybe superfluid phase, or a phase of a Higgs particle, and this would be your gauge field. Notice here, you kind of have this grad E3, it's not gauge in there, it's not a curl of E3, but E3 looks like a gauge potential. And so this is like the Maxwell term. This is in fact complete similarity. This is a Maxwell's term, this is like a magnetic field squared, a curl of A squared. This is kinetic energy, grad phi minus A. And this is like external field. This is like a curl E3 dotted into chirality. So it's trying to twist, put chirality in. Q naught is proportional to how chiral molecules are. So this is like H dot B, this is B squared, and this is, you know, grad phi minus A squared. I think there was a question.
Yeah, you had a question.
Yes. So for conventional liquid crystal, so we have a simple molecules, which is like rods.
Uh-huh, right.
As the order parameter space, it's like sphere with opposite points identified.
Right, RPN, yeah, RP2.
Yeah, RP2. So suppose we slowly go from this situation to a banana molecules.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we have a rod, which is a little bit deformed. And so I would expect that the order parameter space then should be equipped with this additional angle defining how this banana rotates. So
exactly.
I would expect something like RP2 cross U1.
You're exactly right. And yes. So when you say order parameter space, you're doing more than just, you're describing what happens inside the ordered phase. So if you were to try to change the angle and make it more straight, you would lose twist bend pneumatic phase, and you would just go to conventional pneumatics, but then you would go to RP2 by a phase transition from twist bend pneumatic to back to pneumatic. So that's first observation. Second observation is, but suppose I do sit, I'm not gonna make the angle small, I sit like this. So the way you can think of it is, pneumatic is like a headless arrow, or double-headed arrow. And so now, this order parameter has another arrow sticking out of it. Or think of bow and arrow. There's an arrow and a bow. Bow has no ends picked out, it's symmetric. That's the pneumatic part, and this guy is a vector. So indeed, if you wanna capture this phase, and Tom Lubetzky and I in, 2009 or something, in early 2000s, the mid 2000s, wrote a very extensive paper on this, a couple of papers on this. You would need to introduce a third rank tensor rather than second rank tensor, it would be like Tijk instead of Qij. Tijk, roughly speaking, is like ij tells you which way the bow is pointing, and k is a vector around that bow of the arrow in the bow and arrow. So your intuition is exactly right. You would use the three third rank symmetric tensor order parameter to describe a transition into this phase. We call it tetrahedronic phase. Although this phase is chiral, so it has additional features. But suppose you could just ask, just conceptually, what if I have something that has a structure like this that orders? Or bananas order like this without twisting. Without twisting, you would need this third rank order, tensor order parameter. So exactly right.
Great, yeah, I think we run out of questions. And then let's thank the speaker again. And thank you for your time.
Thank you.